Director of Library Services at the Open University. I'm also co-chair of an international conference called M-Libraries, which is associated with ebooks as well, and I'll tell you a little bit about that later. Where I live in the Open University, delivering our learning to students is very much about thinking about students on the move and delivering to mobile devices, of which ebooks are part. And I know that in talking this morning, I'm going to, I think, be talking a little bit about mobile in the broad sense. And I just wanted to give you that context because that is the way in which the university is thinking. It's about engaging with the whole mobile delivery. I, by the way, am staying until lunchtime. I don't have to go after lunchtime. So what I'm going to do this morning is just think a little bit about the context of where we are and the way in which mobile devices are changing the way we work. I want to say a little bit about the OU, and then I'll try to give you a little bit of a demo about the ebook platform that we've developed, and think about the learning teaching issues. And finally, I'll just give you a little bit of feedback about a very small ebook pilot we did with Cranfield in 2009, but actually I think some of the findings remain interesting. So in 2010 we had a report from Horizon which indicated the size of the mobile market and the fact that the development of mobile devices would provide an opportunity for delivering knowledge and learning to all sorts of new kinds of learners, both in an informal and a formal way. Mobile devices are obviously divided into different groups, and it's easier to provide content and to think about providing content to support learning and teaching, depending on the type of device that you're using, whether it's mobile phones, which obviously have the much smaller screens, the personal listening devices, and then the lightweight portable computers, the tablets and netbooks, etc. And the interesting thing is that the devices are becoming increasingly multifunctional and are beginning to support speaking, watching, reading, searching for information, performing calculations, etc. And the integration of these activities is going to be key in delivering learning and teaching. And mobile learning is considered and described as disruptive, especially as learning is often now focused outside the classroom. It's going to empower students in interaction and collaboration and allow a student to connect up learning in their different settings.
She can't get out of it now. How do I get rid of that?
Just press escape, probably do it.
Okay, so at the Open University we're working on the basis that by 2020 the mobile will be the primary connection tool to the internet for most people, mobile in the broadest sense. And our strategy has been developed on the basis that we believe most of our students will have a smartphone almost immediately. One of our researchers in this area, Agnes Guskahun, has looked at a lot of categories of mobile learning to support and has thought about a number of different aspects of this. I think one of the interesting things for me is this blurring of informal and formal learning and the ability to develop personalised learning using mobile devices. I thinking about why students might want to use mobile devices, we think a lot about the flexibility of access learners, the anytime, anywhere, and the importance for many students who are time poor, particularly an aspect of open university work. And the fact that the mobile learning caters for different styles of learning and communication. It empowers students to engage with learning when they feel like it. And it also empowers students as contributors so they can actually deliver content themselves. And there is also the issue that mobile services can support special needs. Connecting remote learners is an important aspect, particularly if we think about the global nature of learning and teaching. If you think about a university like ours, where we have around 30,000 students studying in different countries, how can we link up students and help them to, particularly in remote places, and help them to have a good quality learning experience? Well, using mobile devices is very successful. In the 2011 Horizon report, ebooks are identified as in the 1 year or less time to adoption. Multifunctional devices such as the iPad and the Samsung Galaxy present us with a new class of tools, which merge ebook readers with a wide variety of applications and web access. And I think this is key for using ebooks in supporting learning and teaching. Publishers are beginning to explore rich visual interfaces, including multimedia and collaborative elements. And graphics, video, etc., are going to enhance the reader's experience, and they will engage the young people. If electronic books really have the potential to transform the way we interact with reading materials of all kinds. What are the general challenges then? There's a lack of academic titles. There's a need for features which support scholarly work. Annotations, dictionaries, the ability to highlight. We've heard already about restrictive publishing models and digital rights management. Accessibility is still a significant issue, as is authentication and access management. If you think about the Open University situation, and there are plenty of other Open University Open universities across the world, our students aren't going to come to campus to register their use e-books. They're going to need to be able to do this remotely. We also need to know about usage. How are the e-books being used and when? So we want to know which of our students are using e-books and how does that fit with the course that they're on? Are they using them at the right time or are they using them to browse and think independently? There's not enough research into student preferences and behaviours, and the content that is available is far too text-based. Recently, the M-Libraries conference held a workshop called Evolving Content for Mobile Delivery, and it found huge opportunities for libraries and publishers to increase flexible access to quality academic content. And there is, I think, going to be a GIST call also looking at mobile delivery, which focus on e-books will be very important, and I think that call is under development now. A lot more research needs to be done into all these areas. The key thing, I think, for us in education is to make content easily accessible to younger learners, for whom mobile devices are the channel of first choice, and we have to remember that. I've referred a little to the Open University, and I want to tell you now a little more about the university before I go on to tell you what we're trying to do significantly around the development of an ebook platform. We have at the moment 250,000 students, and they have a very diverse background. Most of them are in employment. About 25% are under 26, and as I said, around 30,000 of our students are studying abroad. We have around 1,000 academic staff and 7,000 tutors. No previous qualifications are required to study with EU. We have something like 2 million alumni. Now, wouldn't that be interesting for publishers to be able to attract? Our students come from very, very diverse backgrounds, and as I've said, are all ages. And we have to think about providing a quality education experience to them without them coming to the campus. Our challenges, though, are very much the challenges of all education establishments. The students of the future are always connected, they're independent, they're multitasking learners, they're orientated to working in groups, they're experiential learners, they're visual, they're producers as well as consumers. And they're deluged with information, and they need to find the shortest route to the things that they need. We deliver a great deal of our material through our VLE. And I personally would like to pose a question as to whether the ebook is the catalyst for developing a completely new type of VLE. We've got a strategy for developing services to mobile devices, and it has a very high priority in the university. And you'll see that one of the things we want to do is to ensure that course materials are available on a range of ebooks and mobile devices. And I'll show you a little bit about how that's been addressed. But also, we're very active as a library in making our website and a range of learning objects available on a range of mobile devices. And we've been working with Athabasca University for a good number of years now, learning how to do this. Now, we started by putting up our texts into a free and open space called OpenLearn. And if you haven't had a chance to have a look at OpenLearn, do so. We put about 10% of course materials up onto OpenLearn, and they're put up in Moodle, so they are within the VLE. We've something like 5,400 learning hours, and we provide a participatory and collaborative environment, so that if you are informal learners, you're doing it, there's no accreditation attached to this, there are no tutors attached to it, but you can look at the materials and collaborate and talk to people. There are wikis and blogs, there are learning clubs, there's instant messenger, flash meeting, Amazon star rating, all those kinds of things. And they're all freely available. So this was the first, if you like, experiment with putting up our materials. And our thinking is now that when we create materials, when we create our course stuff, we need to be able to put it out in a variety of ways. So we need to put it out on the VLE in the usual way. We need to be able to push the stuff out onto OpenLearn. And now we need to put it into a number of new ways, into iTunes U and into eBook and mobile devices. And the next stage of what we did, in fact, was to go to iTunes U. And again, I've left some little brochures, some little cards about how to access iTunes U. But if you haven't been into iTunes U, go in and have a look at some of our eBooks. They're free. We started iTunes U in 2008, and we use it as a new open educational resources channel. And we've had 30 million worldwide downloads of free AV tracks by the close of 2010. Our ebooks went into iTunes U last year. We had 100 at launch, and there should now be something like 400 free ebooks available. And anybody can go and have a look at those and use them. This is taking materials that are in OpenLearn and pushing them out through a different avenue. So what we're looking at is trying to give students the opportunity to access our materials in the ways that engage them. So now I'm going to try to show you an OU ebook. And we'll see what happens. Oh, sorry. This is, before I do that, this is an example of the materials that can come through iTunes U, but these are behind the security, so these are just for students. Additional resources that they can use if they wish through iTunes U. Okay, so this is an Open University Science book, and this is developed on the on our ebook platform, and I hope we're going to be able to see how we can integrate things. More engaging as a tool for students. hours, isn't it?
Actually, do you want to come around here?
Okay, so this shows you, I'm going to show you now, the OU music book. And here's some of the text and the material that's actually in OpenLearn. And this is the material which has then been taken and put into the ebook on iTunes U. So now we've got the same problem. We need to go into YouTube.
Sound.
And here you see, I mean, there's lots to be done. For example, if you can imagine 400 books just on shelves like this, there's quite a lot of work that librarians could usefully do to help people organise and find the books. I don't know if this is going to run.
We've got an internet connection here, haven't we?
I think he's got to join out to Citrix.
Does it look like that?
That's because that's going to happen. So you're able to turn the page, you're able to interact, there are quizzes. You will be able to put in different kinds of data and look at different data analysis, those kind of exercises. So you can see what I said at the beginning was I can see an opportunity for this kind of ebook approach to actually I hesitate to say take the place of the VLE, but you know, really the VLE becomes merged into this kind of interactive experience. Okay, well I'm sorry that that didn't work. And I can show you some little bits of this on my iPad, if you're interested.
Nick, we will get these working over lunchtime or so.
We can try to get this going, okay.
All right, so I'm just now going to tell you a little bit about the 2009 Cranfield OU pilot project, where we just gave out a small number of e-book readers to a small number of students just to see what we were able to do with them. And we had a Sony e-book reader and an iPod Touch. And the kind of issues that came back to us particularly were around the fact that getting content onto the device was tricky, formatting issues, navigation, lack of annotation, functionality, or the ability to interact with the text. Those were the highlights of the feedback. We asked the students about their expectations, and there were comments like, it'll be good to have all the text in one place. I want to be able to slip it in my pocket, and have a couple of dozen books to pick and choose from. And actually, I didn't feel so comfortable with that. It reminded me of the days when I first joined the OU and there wasn't an electronic library. And what the university did was it took, 20, 30 articles, stuck them on the CD and posted them out to the students, and then the students riffled through those. And you kind of feel that's not really a library experience. But nonetheless, these are the expectations. Students also said that they were hoping that the e-book readers would help them to study on the move, perhaps in the odd half hour. I can just pick up and put down the reader when I've got a few minutes. Getting content onto devices was the big problem. Audio files were a problem. Transferring OU materials, which then were in PDF form, was easy to the Sony reader, but the iPod Touch was a touch more difficult. Students said that universities need to think about how to make things easy for students. Students just want to press the button and have it delivered to the device that they have. They don't want to have a particular device. They won't want to have an OU device. the work that we're doing with the reader is about experimenting. It's not about having eventually an OU device. When we looked at commercial content, the library subscribed ebook content was only licensed for PC use, and that was a problem. And students also complained that there were too many places to search for books from commercial suppliers, and there was no guidance on where was the best place to look. And I think that probably is an issue that's still around. In terms of using devices for study, students were pleased with the portability and the flexibility, and some of them described using the devices in bright sunshine or reading in bed. And one read from her Sony whilst she was doing the ironing, so she propped it up and did the ironing. So good multitasking woman there. One other described her having her ebook open while she was doing an online quiz, an assessment quiz, and she described it as feeling a bit like having her papers spread out around her, only she'd got ebooks spread out and then doing her piece of work on her PC. And there were also comments about a decrease in the stress and eye strain from using a computer. Some OU courses are very much delivered online, and so it was interesting that using the ebook reader actually gave a different experience. The challenges which came over were the limited bookmarking, the notes and annotations, and there was a question about whether the devices actually encourage surface reading and skimming rather than deep reading. And just the wish list that came as a result of this little experiment, and I do stress it was a very little experiment. Students wanted to be able to jot notes easily. The size of the reader they wanted was between A5 and A4. They wanted a touch screen, easily navigable, easy navigation, and ability to set their own links at top level. They wanted good bookmarking and easy highlighting, internet access, easy book search to tell you where to find an ebook, easy transfer of content. Now these are interesting. The ability to pull out references when quoting texts. I don't think we've looked at that. And the ability to pull together tag materials when it comes to revision. They've got their eyes on the end game there. So I think, although that study was 2 years ago now nearly, I think those kind of comments are still relevant and interesting for us to take forward. So that's really the end of my main talk, except just to say that the third International Own Libraries Conference is today going on in Brisbane, and although I'm co-chair, I'm here, not there. I've been there virtually, but there's a big contingent of OU people out there. I'm afraid I'm stuck at home with GCSE issues. But September 2012, we are going to bring back to the Open University where we had the first Own Libraries Conference. So I hope that you will look out for the call for papers and perhaps be able to submit some papers. I hope that someone will think about sponsoring us and coming with your card later. And there are two books from the first two conferences. Now, I think the first book is available for free from CILIC in digital format. It's online, and the MLibris 2 book is still available. And there will be an MLibris 3 book which will come out in due time. So after the plug for MLibris, I'm stopping.
Right, that's just in time. Okay, Nicky, thank you very much for being with us rather than being in Brisbane as well. We have no idea. We could probably take a couple of questions. I am conscious of time. Are there any questions for Nicky? One at the front here, from Sean.
I'm Shoshana, Exeter Research Information. I'm interested in what you said about the lack of availability of ebooks, and I wondered whether you were speaking textbooks, because I speak a lot of academic publishers who have a lot of academic content.
Yes, that's what I wrote that down as well. Yes. You know, it's the textbooks that you're specifically, not the monographs. But,
And of course, you know, we in certainly thinking in our environment, we're increasingly chunking stuff. So it may not be the whole book we want, but we might want a chapter or a bit thereof.
Okay, Chris.
It was about just a quick reflection. I remember Martin Bee last year at this conference raving about what he thought the megaphone to informal learning and saying how much he thought the future for the AU was based on YouTube. Do you want to comment on that?
We didn't do very well today, did we?
Putting a lot of material up just for anybody to use for informal learning.
Yes. Well, Martin's view, that's our Vice-Chancellor, Martin Bee, and he, if you haven't come across him, he's got some very interesting videos on YouTube about learning. His passion is informal to formal learning, and he would like us to put up a lot of material on open learn free access and indeed on YouTube and iTunes. He fully supports all this. It is the bottom line, obviously, that you've got to think about.
Okay, that's the one question here, then we have to move on.
I'm just wondering, the books on YouTube, are they full text ones or are they published from OpenLearn?
They are the materials from OpenLearn, which come from our course materials. So it isn't the whole course, but it is good, solid OU material with what we're increasingly getting is all the audio-visual stuff integrated, which is what is different from OpenLearn. OpenLearn's flat, if you like, and this is much more interactive.
Okay. Nicky, you're staying here for
break.
You're here until lunchtime, so you can grab her later, but let's move on.